Alrighty, everyone. Welcome to the final episode of season two of Sunday School is Kewl. Now I was going to do Thessalonians. I was set to do it all season. But I decided in the end, now that'll be a great Kickstarter for season three, episode one, whenever I may do it, which is after the special editions come out. My Vimeo resets in like 2 days, so I can put another 20 gigs of stuff up. That I don't have all of, I don't believe, but at any rate, I'll just keep chugging along with that and doing some other stuff as well. With fun filled, this is it for Sunday School is Kewl season two. So it can be Kewl, like, you know, look, it's not, you know, I like other stuff too, but like sometimes, you know, like these people are so high and mighty, like with their like, don't give me your like Jesus virtue or what. I'm pretty humble. I don't think like that. But, like, you're already in attack, but, like, you don't notice, like, you're sneaking. You're, like, two-faced. You attack me. Like, I have some agenda. But wait a minute, man. Separation. That ain't it. Like-minded with certain people, others not so much. But, I mean, like, look. And I do appreciate certain things. Like, look, with the, like, take, like, Whoopi Goldberg, right? And I even, like, at first, oh, no, what did you do? Like, but then, like, she did not only take it back, but she said it right. I meant both. Because with that one, it definitely, like, he made it about race. Like, but I completely agree with what she's also saying in a bigger picture. It's about, like, it is, like, the ideology of how can, like, a human being, like, to a fellow human being, like, maybe seeming to her absent, like, color of skin issue because they're both, like, pale-skinned about it or whatever, but, like, it speaks to an evil, like, in people, whether it done in the name of race or for, like, you know, Stalin tried it with theism, right? If you're a theist, you can't. Nope. We'll get you. Others have done it in the name of, what about the Inquisition? Remember that one? Oh, it was like, if you're not like, you know, if you say you're Christian, but yet, like, I see you not eating the pork or whatever, you know, like people, I mean, they just like, they're trying to like, if you're an honest, real Catholic, or if you might, like, if I can pin, like, maybe you're Jewish still, like, even if, like, in theory, they don't care about your nationality, but, like, you say you're Christian, you know, then there's, if you're a Protestant, we're really going to get you, whatever, you know, like, there's all kinds of stuff. So, people are stupid. Then look at the, like, Irish in the 70s, and, like, you know, like, I don't know, Bloody Sunday, you know, I don't think he likes Sunday, Bloody Sunday, right? But anyway, I digress. Pretty sure. But, anyway, blah, 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 don't, I have some kind of like fur ball in my mouth. I apologize. All right, so what am I reading for this finale? Well, I was going to do Thessalonians, but I decided I've done two by Paul, right? And I've only done really just a little bit of Peter with the Amos 5/Obadiah one of yesteryear. I read a little of 2 Peter. Just about the day of the Lord, his opinion on it. But I want to read 1 Peter. Why not? I've heard all kinds of crap hurled at this one, too. I mean, it's so, like, sexist, and it's evil, and there's, like, this and that about it. But, like, when you... So I'll just read it in its proper context, and are you kidding me? But yet, I mean, it's all, like, he's preaching peace, like, but he uses words like submit sometimes. In fact, he closes the entire thing by saying, likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And again, he knows he's writing to people. This is a very general letter. This is like, whether he planned on writing a second one or not, this is Peter writing, and he's writing to like everyone in the whole, like, Rome and all over. I mean, any situation you can imagine, people in slavery, both people who have nice, like, masters and, like, cruel ones alike, he's got to speak to. He's writing about this. He's concerned about meek people. And so I think it gets, you know, And he's saying, like, you have to learn to forgive people if you feel wronged by them, or if, like, you think they've hurt you. Like, it speaks to a whole mindset of, like, what it might mean to be Christian, just in general. And when you're persecuted without cause, because remember at the time, like, they're just about to be, he's going to die horribly in Rome, right? And, you know, lots of people are going to die under, like, Nero and that time. And so he very much, it's in that era. I'm not even going to bother with a, like, intro to it or what year it may or may not have been written. It would have, you know, would have been 40s, 50s, and 60s for sure, right? One of them. But I mean, like, at any rate, something like that. Ding, stop that. All right. So here we go. 6 minutes in, and we'll just, that's your intro. And we're just going to read the first epistle of Peter. All right. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to his abundant mercy, has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom, having not seen you, love. Let me read that proper. Who, having not seen you, love. Savvy? So, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom, having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy, inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Of this salvation the prophets have inquired and searched carefully, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, who was in them, was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. To them it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things which angels desire to look into. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ as obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who, without partiality, judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundations of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Savvy? It's a mouthful. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here, you know, like on earth, in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. So one more time, I'll read it. Jesus indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through Jesus believe in God, who raised Jesus from the dead and gave Jesus glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers, and its flower falls away. But the word of Yahweh endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babies, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Savvy? The word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word by which, the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious, you also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he, Jesus, is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word, to which they also were appointed. But you are a chosen generation." He's telling the very people he's writing to, because Jesus is like the prince of like peace and the prince of like everything, because God is his father, is king, right? And he knows like there's the kingdom of heaven. There's like Jesus is royalty, you know, and he, Peter's excited to give good news. So he says, he knows you're getting beat up here, right? If you're these people, and hang in there, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Right? Talking about Jesus. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, Jesus' own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Jesus who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Into Jesus' marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable. This is the usual Christian crap they just don't like. It's not different nowadays than Rome. I mean, beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable if, because of conscience towards God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if, when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that you should follow his steps, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Now it's chapter 3. Wives, likewise. Wives. All right, he's going to do wives and husbands. Likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they, without a word, may be won by the conduct of their wives. He's not saying be submissive because, like, you have to. It's not. He's giving them practical information, like, and he's going to speak to the bigger, like, dynamic of family, to the husband directly. But he's saying, wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives, when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. Basically, like, do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are if you do good and are not afraid with any terror. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. And people say, what do you mean weaker vessel? He's speaking to the fact that especially at that time, but any dynamic, you can turn on TV to this day, there are big shot husbands who realize they're stronger than their wives physically. And so some of them tend to. And so, you don't, that puts you, you don't ever get to do that. He's saying, husbands, likewise, dwell with them, with understanding, giving honor to the wife. Not, you have to submit to the wife, and you have to give honor to the wife, submit to the wife, as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. You have to work together, and your husband and wife. If it applies to you because you're married, then you're either a husband or a wife. And these days, you may, maybe if it's a same-sex marriage, then look, then you have your partner is your wife or your husband. So either way, you have a husband or a wife, right? Or is that too binary? I mean, with the pronouns, you say he or she, but then, like, isn't that binary? Like, you're not allowed to do that either? You have to be fluid about it? And, like, if especially if you are fluid about it, then that means you're perfect and you can't. That should have any thing to do with your content of character, like how you want, what you do, what you like, if you're two-faced or if you're not two-faced, or like that shouldn't get you anything here or there. One should always have the respect of being you're a fellow human being, which means you're a fellow dirtbag, right? You got to be on the lookout, same as me, right? For two-faced people with agenda. So like, no one knows about Twitter mob, cool, like two-faced, like Joker Club. Don't do that. Anyway, back to the lesson. I digress. But that's because of such words, and only such words, right? They take that, and it's like how they don't like the Lincoln statue. It's offensive. Like, it makes the, like, I don't know, whatever they don't like about it, the Antifa people. But the slaves are the ones who, like, paid for it and, like, put that up. So whatever it means to us, like, no, they, I mean, they did, it's how they felt, you know. Anyway. So, back it up one more time. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. And if you know anything else at the time, women had, like, next to no rights. They didn't, like, even in Rome, like, they weren't allowed, like, some man had to get the property for them, even if they were lucky enough to be the landowner, you know. It was, like, very, and that's the Roman one. Then there's, like, you go that way, and there's, like, anyway. So, dwell with them, with understanding, giving honor to the wife, right? Being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. Work together, right? Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another. Love as brothers. Be tender-hearted. Be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of Yahweh are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of Yahweh is against those who do evil. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient, when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls, were saved through water. There is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. You know, I say relationship, well, it's the answer of a good conscience toward God. There is also an antitype which now saves us. Baptism, not the removal of filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him, to Jesus Christ. Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. For we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lewdness, lusts, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. In regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you. They will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel was preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. And above all things, have fervent love for one another. For love will cover a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it as with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. And remember, never say you're an oracle of God. He says, speak as the oracles of God, but do not, you don't say oracle of the Lord. Don't proclaim, wait a minute. Who is saying they're an oracle? It's every oracle for themselves, as we know. All right? Jeremiah is something that's not new. All right? But I'm saying it's the thing. I had a vision of traps shut, and the Constitution was on fire. That's great there, Jimmy Dean, right? All right. Now, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it as with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. And they say, you can't hide the deeds in the dark, preciouses. And you're not them. I'm not them either, but I say that. You know, sometimes I think with the boss stuff, you know, with the gods. I think maybe with the Messiah is a little crap. Don't do that. Verse 12, chapter 4. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, plural, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Spirit of glory and of God. Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit rests upon you. If you're persecuted for wait a minute. Especially for the name of Christ. Blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Everybody identifies as one of the, like, whether you're the atheist one or the Jesus-loving one, or like, well, that ain't it. But like, if you actually, like, you have to be upright. You can't contradict certain things about love. No, nope, we don't want new traditional definition of, like, love. We want, like, you know, new, we like traditional definition of love because everyone knows what that means. You want to bastardize and ruin everything. Biochemically, no different than the word, like, criminal and down by law all day long. That's, wait a minute, invasion of privacy. You've got, like, bullying people into not having the free speech and telling the children certain things to make them scared so that they think there's, like, the world's going to end and they keep their trap shut, you know, to, like, at least prolong that. Well, I mean, whatever you told them in the Harry Potter times, you know what I mean? We don't want to do that. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed. Nope, on their part, he is blasphemed. But on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. Savvy? You don't want to go out actually a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a busybody in other people's matters. It's not that. But on a micro or a macro level, wait a minute here. Like, you can't, wait a minute. Oh, no, no. You don't permit society to, like, be, like, Joker Club pathological. We can pathological. We can be anything. We ain't lying. Just pathological, really. They can be hateful. They can be pathological. That's also true, right? All right. So, anyway, let's get on with it here. I'm just going to read to the end. We're very close to the end here. All right. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him or her glorify God in this matter. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, because remember where he is, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? He's asking. Now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to him in doing good as to a faithful creator. Savvy? And this is the last bit, chapter 5. It's very short. It's a little short anyway, I would say. The elders who are among you and I exhort. The elders who are among you, I exhort. I, who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble, to the penitent. Humility. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. That's like the Christian, like early Christian church, like MO. Like that's what they wanted to like be examples about it. It wasn't complex. It's like the Festivus one. We don't really have, I mean, like, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. Perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Right? So, we are not perfect. So he's saying, but may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, may the God of all grace, may God, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him, to God, be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silvanus, our faithful brother, as I consider him, I have written to you briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God in which you stand. She who is in Babylon, elect together with you, greets you, and so does Mark, my son. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to you all who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. And that's the end of the letter of Peter. The epistle of Peter. And yes, Mark, his son, is that very same John Mark who is Mark, who wrote, who, like, with Peter's help, like, whips up the Gospel of Mark and gets in a fight with Paul. And yeah, that's that guy. He was younger than them. So anyway, she who is in Babylon, I'm not sure who, like, what one of the disciples, elect together with you, greets you. And so does Mark, my son. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to you all who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. All right. So that is the epistle of Peter. So offensive. That's outrageous. Oh my, OMG. It's 2,000 years old, just as practical applications. It doesn't say certain things. It does say other things. And it especially espouses, like, peace, especially, like, wait a minute. You're allowed to be honest about it, but, like, wait a minute. I don't know. That is the final season finale, episode 24 of season 2 of Sunday School with Kewl. And which one is R2? I mean, where is he? He's right there. Bing, 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 bing. Where's Bing? Oh, I don't know. Have a very good day, everyone, all right? Bye-bye.